Hi everyone. Today in this video, let us discuss one of the medication, empagliflozin. What is this medication, empagliflozin? Here the suffix gliflozin indicates that this drug is one of the SGLT2 inhibitor. SGLT2 is one of the pump which is called as sodium glucose cotransporter 2. This is a cotransporter for both sodium as well as glucose in the renal tubules, which is responsible for the absorption of both sodium as well as glucose into the systemic circulation. Now, on this pump, empagliflozin acts as an inhibitor, and this drug is indicated for the people who are having risk of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. This ejection fraction is very important in order to supply sufficient amounts of the blood to the required organs. Now, in the people with heart failure, ejection fraction may be reduced, which is denoted as HFREF. Here, HF indicates heart failure and REF indicates reduced ejection fraction. So, if these conditions are associated with type 2 diabetes mellitus, in such people, the risk of heart failure is more pronounced, which is reduced by empagliflozin. Empagliflozin acts as a sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitor, which reduces the absorption of glucose. This medication is available as tablet, and it mainly acts on the renal system, where it is going to reduce the absorption of glucose, thereby it can affect the glucose excretion. Since glucose reabsorption is inhibited, it increases the glucose excretion within the urine. Along with the glucose, empagliflozin can also increase the other minerals, particularly the sodium excretion is increased, which reduces the body volume, thereby it reduces the cardiac work. So one of the main action of empagliflozin is the volume depletion. It reduces the body volume, thereby it reduces the cardiac work in the people with risk of heart failure. Similarly, this drug can also be used in other conditions like chronic kidney disease, CKD. This is one of the conditions in the people where the glomerular filtration rate is reduced. In such people, we can observe a reduced value of EGFR, estimated glomerular filtration rate. Again, in such people, empagliflozin can be given, which increases the diuresis. But at the same time, in the people with severe impairment of kidney disease, particularly who are having EGFR less than 30 ml per minute per 1.73 square meter. If the EGFR is less than 30, empagliflozin is not recommended. But in the people with chronic kidney disease, where EGFR is greater than 30 ml per minute, this empagliflozin can be given to relieve the symptoms of CKD. So along with dialysis, empagliflozin is indicated to improve the functionality of the renal system. Apart from these clinical indications, this drug can also be used in the type 2 diabetes mellitus, along with other anti-diabetic agents. So today in this video, we are going to discuss how this drug acts, what are the important precautions, side effects, doses, all these things we will discuss in this video. First of all, let us see how this drug acts. As we have discussed earlier, empagliflozin mainly acting on the renal system. One of its primary action is to increase the glucose excretion by reducing its absorption in the renal tubules. Along with the glucose excretion, empagliflozin can also increase the diuresis. It is having the natriuretic effect, where it is going to increase the excretion of sodium as well as water molecules. Because of excretion of glucose, sodium and other minerals, the body volume is going to be reduced, which reduces the cardiac work and cardiac load. So this improves the symptoms in the patients with risk of heart failure. Now within the renal tubules, in the filtrate, glucose is present as well as sodium is present. This glucose and sodium can be absorbed into the systemic circulation from the lumen of the renal tubules. For this, they require some transporters. Now, on the inner membrane, one of the transporters is present, that is SGLT2, sodium glucose cotransporter 2. Through this transporter, both glucose as well as sodium can enter into the renal membrane. But from this membrane, they should be absorbed into the systemic circulation. For that, again, another type of transporters are available. On the outer membrane of this renal tubule, one of the pump is present, that is sodium potassium ATPase pump. This pump allows the sodium for exchange of potassium. Now, sodium can enter into the systemic circulation for exchange of potassium. In this way, sodium can be reabsorbed. However, for the absorption of glucose, specific transporters are required. So these are nothing but GLUT2 receptors. Through these GLUT2 receptors, now glucose can be entered into the systemic circulation. In this way, both sodium as well as glucose can be transported into the systemic circulation. Now, empagliflozin blocks this action. This empagliflozin is an inhibitor of SGLT2 transporter. When this transporter is inhibited, both glucose as well as sodium cannot enter into the systemic circulation. Instead, they can be excreted in the urine through the filtrate. As sodium and glucose are excreted, their levels within the blood are going to be reduced. So this reduces the excessive glucose levels as well as sodium levels, which reduce body volume, thereby to reduce the cardiac work as well as renal workload. That's why empagliflozin can be given in the people with risk of heart failure as well as chronic kidney disease. Now let us the precautions of this medication. One of the important precautions of empagliflozin is that this drug can induce ketoacidosis. This is one of the conditions where the ketone levels in the blood are going to be elevated, which produces various symptoms like severe dehydration, nausea and vomiting, abdominal pain, and shortness of breath. If these symptoms are observed for longer periods, it may indicate elevated levels of ketone bodies within the blood. Ketoacidosis can be thoroughly treated by administration of insulin or administration of sufficient fluids or replacement of carbohydrates. By all these measurements, ketoacidosis can be minimized. Second important precaution is that empagliflozin can produce fungal infections. So in the woman, we can observe vaginal yeast-like infections, and in the men, genital infections can be observed. Another important precaution is that empagliflozin can produce volume depletion. This is one of the required action of empagliflozin, where it increases the excretion of glucose, sodium and water, thereby to reduce the body volume. So this results in the volume depletion, which reduces the cardiac work and increases the cardiac efficiency. But this volume depletion should be within the limits. But in the conditions like excessive volume depletion, the people may have few of the symptoms like hypotension and acute kidney injury. In order to prevent these two conditions, the volume depletion should be thoroughly monitored. And in the people with any renal impairment, empagliflozin should be carefully given, because in such people, we can observe a significant volume depletion. Similarly, with use of loop diuretics, again, precaution should be taken, because loop diuretics are the high ceiling diuretics, which produce a significant volume depletion when they are combined with empagliflozin. And the precaution is that empagliflozin can produce some urinary tract infections. Since it is going to increase the glucose in the urine, more amount of the glucose is present in the renal tubules as well as in the urine. So this can promote the risk of infections, because glucose is a source of energy for bacteria. So empagliflozin can increase the urinary tract infections. Similarly, it can also produce some bacterial infections, particularly at the genitalia. So it can produce some tenderness, redness, and even it can precipitate fever in the people. Finally, this medication can also produce hypoglycemia, that is commonly observed with many of the antidiabetic agents. If insulin is combined with empagliflozin, this hypoglycemia is more pronounced. Similarly, sulfonylureas can also increase the hypoglycemia. So when the sulfonylureas are combined with empagliflozin, the dose of sulfonylureas should be reduced in order to avoid severe hypoglycemia. Now let us see the side effects of this medication. One of the important side effects of empagliflozin is the urinary tract infections. And it can also produce some upper respiratory tract infections, resulting in nasopharyngitis. And even it can produce some increased urination because of increased diuresis. It can also produce some fungal infections and nausea and vomiting. Apart from these side effects, other side effects like joint pain, constipation, and hypoglycemia can also be observed with empagliflozin. Now let us the chemical nature of this medication. So this is the structure of empagliflozin. Here we can observe this is the ring. This is nothing but the glucose-related moiety. This is nothing but D-glucitol. Now to this D-glucitol, a phenyl ring is attached. Let us give the numbering to this glucitol. This is 1 and this is 2. Now if we give the numbering to the phenyl ring, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, and this is 4. So at the second portion of the D-glucitol, 4-chlorophenyl ring is attached. So we can write this as 2-4-chlorophenyl. Now to this phenyl ring at the third position, methyl group is attached. So 3-methyl, and to this methyl, another phenyl ring is attached. Let us give the numbering. This is 1 and this is 4. So that is nothing but 4-oxyphenyl. To this 4-oxyphenyl, an oxalane ring is attached by third position. So this is nothing but 4-oxalane-3-ol. That is the complete name of empagliflozin. Empagliflozin is a D-glucidol derivative. Because of sugar moiety, it can compete with glucose for occupation of SGLT, sodium glucose cotransporter 2. But this inhibits the transporter, thereby it reduces the absorption of glucose and sodium into the systemic circulation. How it is given? This drug is available as a tablet at a strength of 10 mg as well as 25 mg for the people who are having the risk of heart failure or in the people with chronic kidney disease. This empagliflozin given at a dose of 10 mg given once daily. This tablet can be taken either with food or without food. But this drug should not be given in the people with eGFR less than 30 ml per minute. And this medication can also be given in the people who are having the type 2 diabetes. The dose can also be increased to 25 mg. But in order to prevent heart failure and chronic kidney disease, it is initiated at a dose of 10 mg given once daily. So that's all about this medication, empagliflozin. Hope this video is useful to you. If you really like this video, please subscribe to our channel, share this video with your friends, post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.